Good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the second meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2022. The first item on our agenda is to agree to take agenda items 4 and 5 in private. I'm assuming that everyone agrees unless a member indicates otherwise. So does any member object to taking items 4 and 5 in private? Oh, I see no objections, so that's agreed. Can I turn now to the second item on our agenda, which is a session of evidence with representatives from the National Records of Scotland office. This follows a Section 22 report, which was considered by the committee at its meeting on the 9th of December with the Auditor General and a team from Audit Scotland. This morning we are joined, I'm pleased to say, by Paul Lowe, who is the Register General for Scotland and Keeper of the Records of Scotland. And Paul is joined this morning by Linda Sinclair, who is the Director of Corporate Services and also the Accountable Officer within the National Records of Scotland office. Anne Slater is the Director of Operations and Customer Service. Welcome, Anne. And Peter Whitehouse is the Director of Statistical Services at NRS. I mentioned that Linda is the Accountable Officer, but I want to invite Paul Lowe to give us some opening remarks before I turn the meeting over to the committee to ask questions. So, Paul Lowe, over to you.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning, committee members, and thanks very much for this invitation to attend the session today. I'll dispense with introductions as you've covered that already, convener. Today marks 2 months to Census Day on the 20th of March. I'm pleased to confirm that we're in a strong position to deliver Scotland's Census 2022. In a few weeks' time, our public awareness campaign launches, and from the 28th of February, every household across the country will receive a letter advising how to participate. We only have one opportunity to deliver the census and to get it right. It uniquely asks the same questions of Scotland's population with reference to the same point in time. Its insights provide rich data at national and local level, providing benefits for many years after the census collection. It informs the allocation of budgets, the delivery of infrastructure, research activities, and the provision of services. For the census to be effective, an extremely high response rate is required. It is vital that we enable everyone to participate in the census. Following lockdown in March 2020, NRS conducted a comprehensive impact assessment on the risks of the pandemic to the delivery of the census. Through this, we concluded that the only option which secured the high level of response rate and high quality standard was moving the census to 2022. This recommendation was not made lightly. We considered balancing the risks of delivering a poor quality census in 2021 and the long-term impacts this would have with the impacts of making a delay of a year, but with increased confidence of achieving a successful outcome. The census is subject to an extensive programme of external assurance. These point to high confidence in our readiness. Indeed, the most recent Scottish Government Technical Assurance Review provides a delivery confidence assessment of the programme for Amber Green, which is a very significant achievement for a programme of this scale and complexity. It is noteworthy that our UK counterparts went live at Amber status, reflecting the strong position that Scotland's census is in. Thank you for your attention. I'm happy to take questions from the committee.
Thank you very much indeed, Paul. And can I say to you, if you want to bring in members of your team in order to field any of the questions, please do that and just let us know who is the appropriate person. And similarly, if members of your team do want to come in, if they could put an R in the chat box function and that makes sure that I will call them. I just wanted to put a little bit of context to this morning's session, because a Section 22 report by Audit Scotland is quite a serious matter, and happens when there are there have been or there are still some alarm bells ringing. And we just want this morning to I think probe a little bit into the journey that you've been on, and also how things look over the course of the next few weeks, because as you say, the census has still to be delivered. And I just wanted to start this morning by reflecting on the second paragraph of the Audit Scotland report, which contains this note. I have prepared the report, says the Auditor General, to draw the Scottish Parliament's attention to the challenges facing NRS in the delivery of the census programme. This includes the significant impact the decision to delay the census until March 2022 has had on NRS's costs. These are also ongoing risks to delivery of the programme, including resourcing and financial pressures, which NRS will need to continue to manage so that the census can be delivered successfully in line with the revised budget and timetable. And members of the committee this morning, I think, will return to those themes over the course of the next hour. I just wanted, Mr. Lowe, to reflect on the evidence session we had with the Auditor General, where you may have seen one of the issues that that was brought to our attention was that there had been an options appraisal report, which led you through evidence, presumably, to the decision or the recommendation to ministers for their decision to postpone the census for a year, which was a very big decision to make. Now, we asked Audit Scotland if they had had sight of the options appraisal report, and they may have had sight of it, but they were not in a position to offer it to us. I wonder whether it would be possible for us as a committee to see in full the options appraisal report.
Happy to do so, convener. I'll follow up in writing after this session. You want me to say a bit more about the options appraisal at this point?
Yes, I think it would be useful if you want to take us through the broad themes of that and why you arrived at the decision to postpone that you came to.
Thank you, convener. As good practice in any programme, it's important to assess risks and issues in the environment that might threaten the delivery. And I think this is an appropriate example of where this has been done in a programme. So at the advent of lockdown in March, we started to assess what were the issues that the pandemic and lockdown might present to the delivery of the census programme and achieving success. And there were a number of factors that drove that. The first, obviously, was that our staff virtually overnight went from working in offices and teams to working from home and working remotely. Our contractors and suppliers were put into the same position. And our health services and others were focused on dealing with a national crisis. So what we could start to see were impacts on the ability to collaborate with other organisations, which is very important in the census, productivity in the delivery of the census, and great uncertainty about the length and duration and significance of COVID-related disruptions to the programme. Now, at that stage, we were less than 12 months out from delivery. It's not wise, if you can avoid it, to cancel a programme at the 11th hour. The costs are very significant. People have been advised and informed of the date of the census and how to participate, and you have to unwind all of that. So you do need to make decisions with adequate time on these matters to do it in a safe and a controlled manner. I mentioned collaboration. When we deliver a census, we have to work very closely with a range of partners, and very significant partners are local government and the NHS. And at that point in time, understandably, if you'll remember, as we all do, the unprecedented pressures that health and care sector were facing at the time. And we had to ask ourselves some questions. Was it appropriate for us to have detailed engagement with them about delivery of the census when they were being abstracted to deal with a very significant national crisis? There were a number of other factors that we took into account. We also were mindful of what conditions would exist in Scotland were a census to be taken in March 2021, and the risks that we could be in lockdown or other equivalent conditions during that time. Now, a very significant element of the census collection, even with the digital delivery that we're planning, is a field force, so teams of staff who will remind or assist people who have not completed the census after census day. We're very mindful of the public health concerns and the great uncertainty that existed at the time. Obviously, there was no vaccination. There was limited information about how transmissible and what was safe to do at that time. That would it be appropriate, and indeed, would it be within the law to run a field force operation in March 2021? Now, obviously, that was a risk-based assessment at the time, but events transpired that in March, Scotland was in lockdown. England came out of lockdown in early March, but Scotland was in lockdown through March. And it wasn't until into April that Scotland moved to stay local, which was again a very significant level of restriction in the country. So I think there's something in our risk assessment around that, which indicated some of the factors around collaboration, our ability to work with organisations. We have to enumerate hospitals, care homes, prisons, hotels, other places, and would that activity be appropriate in the peak of a pandemic? And our assessment were there lots of risks around that. We did, however, follow that exercise up because it's quite a significant step to consider the possibility that action may need to be taken with the census. So we did undertake a comprehensive risk assessment exercise. We looked at a number of things, different options for delivering the census that would allow us to retain the existing March 21 delivery date, options that basically delivering the census in the way that we'd anticipated we would, retaining the delivery date but reducing the scope of delivery of the census, so we'd retain the delivery date but we would reduce the complexity and the risk around the census, and options that would involve delay. And we looked at these through different lenses. We looked at them through the lens of financial impact, risk, feasibility and viability. And we then looked at it through a number of different criteria. And as I say, we can expand on that when we send you the risk assessment document. But our conclusion was that when we looked at our programme plans and the timescales and the activities that we had to undertake, the disruption from the pandemic would exhaust our contingency time in the programme. We just would not have the time to deliver the activities that we have planned. As you'll appreciate, while the census is a programme run over a number of years, the activity in the year leading up to the census is the most intense. So in light of that, we looked at different options. We had conversations with our colleagues in ONS to see if there were mitigations or steps or support that they could provide, and we had very helpful conversations, but we reached conclusions for reasons I'm happy to explain later on if helpful, that wasn't viable. We then looked at a range of different options, which were de-scoping elements of the census to retain the March 21 delivery date. Those intrinsically had to involve the removal of field force element, because that involves a large-scale recruitment of about 3,500 to 4,000 people to work across Scotland. So there's a mass recruitment, mass training exercise, and then a mass deployment exercise. That's a very significant piece of work and would require significant mitigations to be put in place for COVID. So having recognised that we didn't have contingency time in the plan left, the way to get us back on track would be to remove that element. But I bring us back to quality. And the expectation with the census is a very high response rate. A low response rate leads to an ineffective census and one that's not of value. So all of these options, and we looked at running our digital platform only, we looked at running paper-based form approaches only, and we looked at running digital and paper form simultaneously, which is what we did in our rehearsal. But all of those through our modelling indicated that we would get a response level much lower than we would require to get from a census. So for clarity, we would expect and need a response rate of in excess of 90%. In 2011, we secured a 94% response rate. Our modelling indicated that these different options provided between 60 and 80% response rates, so too low to justify the quality threshold of the census. And obviously, convener, it's not just
I think Mr. Lowe has frozen. I don't know whether we're able to. Sorry, Mr. Lowe, you froze. We didn't get the last 60 seconds of your.
I was just saying, Convener, that the high quality threshold is really important here. Nationally, we're looking for an in excess of 90%, but we also have to be mindful of response rates at local community levels, because that local data is part of the uniqueness of the census. And the final aspect that we considered was also what public appetite would be to interact with field force staff and participate in the census during a lockdown period as well. People were obviously very concerned. We had people shielding at that time still. The vaccination program was going to be very much in its infancy. And at the time we did this assessment, there was no identified vaccines for COVID. So hopefully that gives you a bit of a sense of some of the range of factors that we took into account.
Yes, thanks. That's helpful. I mean, I just do want, though, to go back to the fact of the matter, which is that in England, Wales and Northern Ireland, the census did go ahead in March 2021, didn't it? And there was a 97% participation rate, as I read it. So, you made the point about the different status that Scotland was in at different points in the month of March 2021. Which is clearly a factor, but notwithstanding that, we've also been told that one of the reasons why ONS and the Northern Ireland Statistics and Research Agency were able to go ahead was because they had in place access to other four sources of administrative data, presumably which would be there for them to rely on to add texture to the returns that they were getting from Census Day. I mean, could you explain why NRS didn't have access to those same sources of administrative data?
So I think, just to be clear, in terms of the delivery of the censuses in other parts of the UK, which is relevant, ONS is responsible for the delivery of the census in England and Wales. It also provides most of the capabilities that Northern Ireland used to deliver the census. So it delivers the online systems and various sources of support, while Northern Ireland delivers a field force and a public information campaign. So most of the delivery of the census across the rest of the UK is delivered by ONS. So it's a massive programme. There's a number of factors here about administrative data. I think the first thing is, I think there maybe was a bit of confusion about administrative data that perhaps crept in the evidence session that you referenced. Administrative data was not developed as a contingency for ONS's census. Administrative data is something, is a program of research work that the ONS have been working on for many, many years as part of their broader functions. So in NRS, I am not running a mini Office of National Statistics. I'm running an organization that's very different. So in terms of statistics, I'm responsible for demographic statistics, population statistics. In Scotland, ONS have a very broader remit. So they undertake a range of social surveys, they undertake economic statistics reporting, workforce, various other things. They're not part of the organisation. My organisation, in terms, has a large number of functions that ONS doesn't. So I'm responsible for the registration of births, deaths and marriages in the country. I'm responsible for the National Archives. I'm responsible for the public records system and various other things, so there's quite different functions in the organisation. So ONS have been looking for some time at how they might use data that exists in other government organisations that would assist it in its broader statistical functions. Now, they have a legal gateway to do so through the Statistics and Registration Services Act. There is potentially elements of that legislation that might allow other bits of the UK, other devolved administrations, to enter into discussions with UK government departments about access to data. But I have to stress the following: administrative data is experimental statistics. It's not sort of confirmed national statistics. ONS have had a programme over many years of discussion with large government departments about how they might get access to this data, and those discussions are not yet fully successfully concluded in progress. So during their assessment of the impact of COVID on their programme, they reached a view that an option available for them would be to take work from their separate programme on administrative data and potentially fill in gaps in responses if they had a poor response rate to COVID. Now, that gave them sufficient confidence that access to that data would allow them to do so. That having been said, there were risks in that, because administrative data is information sitting on a range of government systems, often for operational purposes. They wouldn't know until they'd run that census whether they had the right data available to them, how current that data was, and there were risks of gaps, but they felt that that provided them with sufficient assurance, and I'm absolutely certain that was the right call. For the purposes of running of data sharing with organisations, I need to have a legal gateway, but I also have to have a purpose. So my purpose is to produce demographic statistics. So I need to crudely know three things: how many people are born, die, and marry in Scotland. Now, I have that data because I control the registration system. And how many people migrate to Scotland. And there's an existing national statistical model which is used across ONS, Wales, Northern Ireland, and in Scotland that measures migration. So I don't have an immediate justification to approach Department of Work and Pensions, HMRC, and others and ask for data, which I don't require.
Can I check then? Because we were told in the evidence session with Audit Scotland that you were now planning to access some of those data sharing sources. Are you saying that you haven't done that, or you've got no legal basis for doing that, and that's not happening?
So what we're doing for the 2022 census, convener, is that we have been in discussion with Scottish organisations and also data sets that NRS owns as well, to use elements of administrative data to quality assure. So it's not being used to fill in data gaps. It's a far less broad coverage of administrative data. It's not access to DWP or HMRC case information on individual citizens. It's a very, very specific purpose. So it's part of our quality assurance arrangements, but not how we would deal with a no or a biased response rate.
Okay, look, thanks for clearing that up. And I must ask you to try to keep your answers a little bit briefer. I suspect in the forthcoming sections you will be able to do that. And again, please feel free to bring in members of your team, Mr. Lowe, if you think that they can add useful evidence to the gathering of information that we're embarking on. I want to now invite Craig Hoy to ask a number of questions. Craig.
Thank you, Richard, and good morning, Mr. Lowe, and welcome to your colleagues. Just wondering if you give us a bit of a flavour on your assessment and what work you did around assessing the impact of the delay of the census on the delivery of public services in Scotland, and also on the allocation of funding, for example, to councils and other public bodies.
Thank you, Mr. Hoy. Yes, we obviously undertook a range of investigations around that as part of our decision making. What I would state from the start is that Professor Cerian Diamond, the national statistician and the head of ONS, has stated that there are no insurmountable challenges with Scotland running the census a year behind other parts of the UK. So hopefully I can provide that reassurance to start. The census is a really important exercise. It gathers data, but it gathers data for a fixed point in time, and we then need to use data on population that goes beyond that census year. So each year, ourselves and other parts of the UK generate statistics called mid-year population estimates. So we use the last census and we make adjustments. As I explained to the convener earlier, in Scotland, that's about taking the 2011 data. It's about then having the data for births and deaths in Scotland, which I have anyway as the Registrar General. And it's about taking migration data, and we have a UK agreed protocol for how that's developed. So each year we are able to develop statistics based on that census baseline that cover the needs, whether it's allocation of funds to Scotland, whether it's regional allocation of funds by government to the NHS and local authorities. And that's a very robust model. There is a parallel case in 2011. The results of the Scottish census that were delivered by General Register Office of Scotland at the time, the publication of the results from the census were a few months out of sync with England, Wales and Northern Ireland, which meant that Scotland went for an additional year using baseline data from the 2001 census. When the results of the actual census in 2011 were compared with that model data, there was less than 1% difference at population level between the two. So we do know that that data set is and that approach to modelling between years is really robust. We also undertook a range of discussions with ONS and other statistical providers and worked through that. And we're continuing to engage in a really productive way with all of the different UK statistics bodies.
Okay, but obviously that was quite focused on process. I suppose we are now going to be out of sync. You identified that there were challenges but said they were insurmountable. So could you perhaps let us know what some of those challenges are?
I think for the detail of that, I'll hand over to Pete Whitehouse, who's my sort of Director of Statistical Services. But I think the main thing is in the use of funding allocations. And as I've explained, this is about using an existing methodology that we use each year between censuses and extending it for 1 year extra. So I don't see the impacts as significant, but perhaps we could bring Pete in.
Thanks.
Okay, morning, committee. Yes, so in one of the fundamental deliveries of the census is to deliver that population figure. And part of that is to drive allocation and support and inform allocations within the country. But it's also about working with colleagues across the UK to deliver UK population data. As Paul has set out, we work very closely with ONS and with Welsh Government and Northern Ireland to bring together our data. And the way one has always looked at population data is you bring the best data that you have. So after the 2011 census, there was a gap between when data was made available for the rest of the UK and when Scotland brought its census estimate online. That was managed. It was managed through the Government Statistical Service. It was managed by considering how to look at when retrospective adjustments could be made. And essentially, the work was done with colleagues across government to make sure that the allocations were done as they could be, and where there was a need to revise when better data was coming on stream, that was then done. We are working very closely, and Paul mentioned Ian Diamond, who has been very strong in this position, about how we work together as statistical organisations to deliver the quality of data that's required by our users. We do that by looking at our mid-year estimates, by rolling forward from the last census, by bringing on the new census data when it comes online, and by working with each other to understand how migration is moving, how on our births and deaths information, and we do that collaboratively. That is also overseen by the Office of Statistical Regulation, who have a very, very keen interest in how UK statistics and how population data is used and how it is informing our formulas in particular around that allocation. So there is a great deal of work that is going on. It will continue to go on. And what we will be delivering is the best available data that we have at the time. Our allocations, as I say, within Scotland, we have as you probably know, that there's the health allocations, the local authority allocations make great use of population data, but they also build on allocations from previous years and have rolled that forward. So we feed into that. And at all times, we will deliver the best data that we have at the point. And it goes very much to Paul's, one of Paul's earlier points, is that we know the quality of the data is so important that we have to get that right. And the challenge is the risk of going with data that doesn't meet its needs against the obvious downside of being a year later than we might have been. And our conclusion is that being 1 year later, when we have processes in place, when we have methodological solutions, when we have engagement with our colleagues, is not as bad an option as producing a census that is not fit for purpose, that doesn't have coverage, that is biased. I hope that's helpful.
Yeah, yeah. And when Mr. Ball was before us, we talked with him about the potential impact of a further delay in the census. I think the last 40 hours and the data that's emerged probably means this is less likely to happen. But I'm just wondering if you could perhaps give me a flavour, Mr. Lowe, of what options NRS has considered for the census if lockdown restrictions returned, and also have any resources or has any money been committed to contingency planning for that?
Thank you, Mr. Hoy. I think part of what we've done is we've used the last year to make sure that we have flexible ways of delivering the census based on a range of different COVID scenarios. So we've used the time and used some of that additional money to assist with that. So essentially, we have a range of things that we can do. So our intention would not be, you know, even without the very positive data that's been received in recent days, as you say, but things can, of course, get worse in quite a short period of time, sadly, with COVID. So the first thing is that we have a headquarters function, you know, that directs the operation of the census. So we've developed a capability to run that headquarters function remotely if we need to reduce the risk of key people being taken out of commission by being ill with COVID. So we have the capability of running a physical or a remote setup for the headquarters function. We have a contact centre, and the vast majority of that contact centre capability will now be delivered by operators working in different locations rather than in large teams in a single site. So that massively reduces the impact on them. We've made some changes to the delivery of the census. So in 2011, we had community hubs where people could go and attend and get help and support and advice. We've taken a decision not to run those community hubs this time. But what we're doing is we've massively increased the size of our contact centre so that we'll have staff who are able to speak to people and help them, give them advice, talk them through it, and if necessary, help them to complete their census return. So we've invested in that. We've also invested in a range of other technologies, web chat, lots of online advice, lots of help in the online system. The other changes we've made are in respect to the field force. So in the 2011 census, we had 7,000 field force staff, and in prior census exercises, it was higher than that. As part of our digital design, we are moving to much lower field force staff. So if we think about it, if people complete it online, they don't need to interact with anybody else. They can do it safely in their own home. If they want a paper form, they can go online and request one, or phone, and they'll be provided with one. It will be posted to them. Nobody will turn up on their doorstep from NRS to hand them a census form at the doorstep. The other thing that technology allows us to do is, rather than sending field force en masse across all of Scotland, we'll be able to target the field force to the places where people haven't responded, and we'll know that from our systems. So that means many fewer interactions on the doorstep, and it will be targeted. Finally, we've invested a lot in the training of our field force and the kit and equipment. So the interactions will be at doorstep on a distance. They will be short term. And we're engaging closely with the CMO's office around our protocols and arrangements to ensure that they're content with our plans and proposals. Hope that helps.
Yeah, thanks for that. Just one final question, I think, before we move on to the financial impact of the delay. But I just want to put that number out there. I think that the cost of delay was 21.6 million. Would it be right to say, just listening to that last answer, that even though there's a perception that that money may be lost, you've actually used it to invest in putting in greater flexibility, agility and efficiency into the system? So maybe in a sense, crisis begets opportunity here.
Absolutely, Mr. Hoy. I don't think any of this money's wasted. It's been about making sure that the technology we've developed and other things is continues to be refined and improved. So we've used the time to do additional engagement with users and stakeholders to improve the systems, to improve the services. We've used the time to learn lessons from the ONS and NISRA rehearsals, so censuses as well. So as part of that close collaboration Pete references, we've gathered lots of lessons learned in the experience, and we've made sure that we've built that into our programme to make it stronger. There's also, during lockdown, been a significant uptick in cybersecurity incidents. Anyone who sees the press will see the range of global impacts of that. And so we've taken the time to do additional testing and strengthen our cybersecurity arrangements as well. Just on that finance figure, just before I hand back, I agree that 21.6 million is a significant proportion of the programme cost. The things I would note are, we are having to balance a risk of a census that cost 117 million not delivering versus an additional cost to achieve the benefits of the census. International studies and UK studies indicate that for every £1 invested in a census, there is between £5 and £6 equivalent returned in wider economic value. The ONS, as part of their decision making not to delay their census, calculated that their cost to delay their census by a year were £360 million. Now, their cost for delivering the census programme were in the range of £906 million. So you're looking at a relative cost of well in excess of 35%. So I think that probably helps situate the 21.6 million and the 18% increase to show that we have really taken this seriously. We've tried to keep the cost of running additional year down, but you can't be too stringent, because you just don't get a good quality census and good quality census data if you cut too deep in doing so. Hope that helps.
Yeah, thanks very much. Thanks, Richard.
Thanks, Craig. And we will return to one of the issues you raised, Mr. Lowe, in your answer to Craig Hoy's questions, which is about the digital dimension. And I'll come to Willie Coffey to ask some questions on that. But before I do that, I want to continue this theme about the financial implications of the delay to the census. And I want to bring in Colin Beattie. Colin.
Thank you, convener. I'll direct my questions to Paul Lowe, and if it's appropriate, he bounces them on to others. The financial impact at 21.6 million, on the face of it, seems a lot of money. You've mentioned that some of this was used positively in investing into other preparations, and I'm struggling a bit with that, because what I'm seeing is that we're seeing increased supplier costs are 14.4 million, and that's because of extending supplier contracts, as well as an increase in the cost of goods. What were the goods that are so significant that they contribute to that 14.4 million? And how is it that we've managed to turn this into a benefit when it's the suppliers that are getting the increased cost?
Thanks, Mr. Beattie. I mean, I'll hand over in a second to Linda Sinclair, the accountable officer, who can answer that in greater detail. But the reschedule allowed us to do a number of things. The census programme, just in the same way that the census programmes in other parts of the UK use a hybrid of organisational resources and capability and a chain of contracts and services to deliver the census. So there is inevitably, if you extend the duration of the census, an increase to suppliers, because they have to remain on that contract for a year longer and they have to be involved in the work. However, what I would say is, and it's back to the benefit point, is that we use that time well. We increased and used additional testing to make sure that we were in a robust place to deliver the census. We used the opportunity to make some improvements to the census, and those are an element of the supplier costs that are referenced here. But perhaps I could hand over to Linda Sinclair, who can pick up in more detail.
Linda, if you want to come in now, that'd be great.
I think you're on mute, Linda.
There we go. Hopefully that's off now. Good morning. Thank you for asking this question. The supplier costs did total around 14.4 million of the 21.6 million. We went through two rounds of costing with the suppliers to kind of make sure that we were getting value for money from the different contracts. We have around about 20 separate contracts on the census programme, and a range of those are providing different services to the programme. So within that period of time that we had available, we could also then look at what the design was, as Paul's touched on, in terms of the things we were actually asking our suppliers to provide for us. So working through the learnings from ONS and NISRA and looking at specific contracts and working through what that would actually then mean in terms of the activities that they were delivering for us. So as an example, some of the activities are very much volume and demand led. So we can then look at within that kind of period from March and April when the census is running live. I'm getting a problem with my network, so I'm not sure if you can hear me. Can you still hear me?
I can hear you perfectly.
Fine. Good, that's grand, because I got a message up on my screen there. So we were looking at, for example, on those contracts, how much we were needing to draw down at different points and different times. For example, with our different suppliers such as APS, and working through the sort of detail of the activities that they were taking so that we could make sure that we were getting maximum value from each of the individual contracts. Happy to write with more detail on that, because it is a very complex picture to kind of capture in a short period of time. But it was around looking at the kind of value that we can actually achieve from the additional costs and the design of what's in those contracts. And that changes over the period of time as we've got more learning from the likes of ONS and NISRA.
The impression I got from Paul Lowe was that the actual 21.6 million is mitigated by the benefits that you've been able to achieve in additional experience and, you know, being able to look more closely at the programme and enhance it and so on. But that still doesn't actually mitigate 21.6 million. It's still costing 14.4 million than it would have had the census gone through. And it says specifically here that it's due to the cost of extending suppliers' contracts. Now, I don't know whether you've negotiated with the suppliers to change the contracts, which would obviously create an additional cost element. And it's mentioned that part of it also is the increase in the cost of goods. Now, what are those goods that are so significant?
So in terms of the extension to the contracts were had enough flexibility in those that we were extending the time period. So the major aspects in terms of the cost drivers are around the continued resourcing. So we have an arrangement working with our different suppliers where we're drawing on the resources to work with us to deliver the census. So we were then allocating that work across the kind of additional year. So there's an additional resource requirement for the suppliers, and that was a major part of the costs, together with continued licensing. So we were having to extend our license costs for some of the digital equipment and the sort of digital licenses that we have in place for delivering census. And the other aspects around the hosting and support costs by the suppliers. So it was the underpinning costs that the suppliers were delivering for us in terms of actually allowing us to then deliver the census in a collaborative environment with the suppliers. So there are a range of things within the design of that allowed us to then look at how do we get better value out from within how we're working and how we're delivering census with our suppliers. But those were the better value.
Apparently the better value came at a cost of 14.4 million.
That's the total cost.
And here I'm still struggling a bit about the positivity in this. You had a bit of extra time, which gave you a chance to spend more time enhancing and improving the delivery of this, which presumably had a cost in itself, which I assume is rolled up into that 14.4 million. And you still haven't answered the question about what are the goods that are so significantly increased in price that they warrant to mention.
So, in terms of the particular pricing aspects. We've got a range of different contracts. Some are based on framework contracts, and so we're based on Scottish Government pricing. And there are flexibilities within those that actually then increase the pricing of the contracts. So, for example, changes to Royal Mail prices will then impact in terms of our overall kind of pricing around how much it costs us then to send out and post out the paper forms, for example. So that's one impact we've had to price into part and parcel of the additional costs. There are other impacts in terms of changes in licensing costs, where there's flexibilities under individual contracts as well that we need to kind of put in place. The part of the other costs in terms of the 14.4 million was also additional costs for manual coding. So as part and parcel of the rehearsal for the programme, we had a look at kind of how do we run the manual coding element. So there was around about £1 million worth of the 14.4 million that were for manual coding and additional activities associated with that from learnings with the rehearsal. So there's a cost in terms of how long it will take to code individual paper forms that come back in, and that was based on learning from the rehearsal that it would take slightly longer. So that also is a sort of cost driver. There's a whole range of different cost drivers. It's hard to encapsulate it in one simple response in relation to that.
But what you're telling me is that the original specifications for delivery of the census, in fact, were under budgeted, because you're saying that some things would have taken longer, and you found that out and you've added that into the cost subsequently. So it appears to me that your original costing probably was not accurate.
It's the impact of adding an additional year and asking our suppliers to work with us for an additional year, and the cost of their resourcing and the cost of the supplier and the hosting costs for that additional year that make up the vast majority. But it is about the length of time.
But you were talking about coding of pieces of paper.
That's one other element.
And you raised that specifically, and you said that the exercise you did showed that it would take longer than you had anticipated. So that must indicate you would have had a budget overrun had the original census gone ahead.
Yeah, we would have. That's one element of the 14.4. So I suppose there was two elements of additional goods that, you know, I drew attention to. One was around the Royal Mail pricing under a framework contract, and the other is in relation to the additional costs around manual coding, which would have been an additional cost we would have incurred in any case. And I think we've set that out previously.
Now, the convener asked for a cost of the a copy of the options appraisal. Can I just confirm that will contain details of the additional costs that would have been incurred had the census gone forward in 2021?
Yes, we did look in the options appraisals at a range of different aspects had the census gone ahead in 2021. So Paul set out the different options in terms of using no field force. We also looked at costings around mitigations associated with, you know, not using a field force, but or going paper only, in terms of how that might then impact, for example, manual processing of paper forms, increased postage costs associated with paper forms, etc. So it looked at a range of the different costings associated with that.
Can I confirm also that the options appraisal will contain details of the estimated additional expenses that were expected due to COVID mitigations if you'd gone ahead with the census in March 2021?
There was an element around mitigation costs that would be an impact in relation to COVID, but what we didn't price at that point was, for example, if we needed to use PPE equipment and such like. It was a difficult kind of position at that point to kind of get a sense around what that exact pricing would be. But we can look at what information that we had at the time and set that out with you.
Okay. You said that supplier costs increased, and that's a substantial portion of the increase in the programme. What did you do to mitigate these costs? What actions did you take?
We went through two rounds of discussions with our suppliers in terms of the overall costs, working through what the impact would be to kind of run forward the programme for an additional year and then interrogate the costs. That we had an indicative set of costings from suppliers that we interrogated and went back to suppliers on the detail of that to ensure that there was sufficient contingency in place, but equally ensure that there was no cost overruns included within that. We also did quite a significant resourcing review on the programme to look at the programme, which was the other main driver of costs, look at the programme resourcing and ensure that that was sufficient, but also it wasn't overplaying the additional resource requirement for the programme, and we scrutinised the detail on that to kind of ensure that we were achieving value for money.
Now, you did yourselves identify financial pressures of 1.5 million in the census earlier in 21-22. Now, you've reduced that to 0.5 million through implementation of mitigating actions. What are those mitigating actions?
So we've undertaken a range of different activities this year in terms of the census budget. There is fluidity to the delivery of census, which does mean that the budgets, you know, will change, etc., over the period of time. Partly, we've gone through a deep dive to prioritise spend and ensure that we're prioritising spend on all the things that we absolutely need, and there's not nice to haves within there that we can actually then recycle savings on. We've looked at supplier contracts again, and we've recycled savings on things like TNS, which haven't been required in the kind of COVID environment. We've also gone through a lot of the census delivery is based particularly for March, April next year, on volumetrics. It's volume-based, volume demand-led based in terms of the numbers of people who will submit a response online versus those who will submit a response on paper, because there's different processing costs associated. So we have assumptions built into census that are based on the numbers and the proportions that might work in different ways, and how many forms that we maybe need to post out versus how many we need to process manually. So we've taken learning from ONS and NISRA in terms of their numbers. We've reassessed all our volumetrics and our assumptions in that very much live period, which crosses the end of the financial year, which obviously then means that we're needing to kind of look very carefully on a day-by-day basis when some of those costs will land from an accrual accounting perspective. So we've gone through the detail of those volumetrics, and we've worked down some of those costs to kind of make sure that we're in a more realistic position. We've looked carefully at the alignment of costings at the year end, to ensure that we're not loading, you know, quite large sums of money for postal drops, for example, in the last days of the financial year, and it is appropriately timed. And that has allowed us then to kind of bring down the costings. We've also continued to kind of keep a clear and careful view in terms of our overall resourcing costs. So there's a very kind of strict kind of control regime in relation to resourcing to ensure that we're keeping those managed and we're keeping those affordable over the programme.
Can you confirm that you've now achieved financial balance?
There are still some uncertainties that we're working through. So I mentioned the Royal Mail pricing, for example. So we're waiting for that kind of confirmation to come through from Royal Mail, which is coming through in the last couple of days, and that's being kind of costed out within the programme, so that we can then look at, you know, where we sit within the balance around that, and whether we've got sufficient funding from there. We're very close to that financial balance in terms of, and we're confident that we will bring the budget into balance at the end of the financial year.
I mean, the figure I saw is 0.5 million still as a gap.
It's around about that. It's between balance and 0.5 million. There's a fair number of aspects that are still moving on that. We're going through some detailed resource costings as well to the end of the financial year. So we will be having a kind of another updated set of numbers coming through, but we're very close to kind of balance, and certainly that's our kind of confident position.
One of the main costs is obviously people. And I just wonder what you're doing to manage the workforce costs, and particularly temporary staff, you know, the numbers that you have and so on. What are you doing to make sure that you're keeping tight on that?
So census for NRS, census is kind of making up around about 30 to 40% of our current workforce. So we have to grow quite significantly, particularly in the years surrounding the census, to actually deliver census. So it's not sustainable for us to kind of carry that level of, you know, permanent staff. So we go through a range of different recruitment resourcing approaches where we look to try and work and bring on board the individuals on a most affordable basis. We have a workforce plan that allows us then to kind of forward plan the costs and you know, kind of look through what the financial implications are of the resourcing plan. And we also go through a work-based control kind of process to allocate the resources to kind of keep a very kind of tight view in terms of our overall costings. We have also gone through regular resource reviews and will continue to do so. And we've just recently, in sort of the back end of last year, completed another resource review, and we've got one planned for sort of May, June this year as well, so that we're going through that kind of regular cycle of refreshing the information around our resources. We do go on the basis of looking to kind of bring in the most affordable route first, and, you know, bring in resources through the most affordable route. That is not always possible because of the nature of kind of very specialised roles that we bring in for census. And also we are, you know, at the mercy very much of the wider sort of prevailing contract market or the resourcing market. And so some of those quite more specialised digital skills are hard to reach and can attract a premium in terms of the activities. But there is tests all the way through before we actually, you know, agree to actually go out to the external market to bring in some of those more hard to reach and higher cost premium resources.
OK, thank you very much. Back to you, convener.
Thanks, Colin. And thanks to Linda for her answers to those questions. And just a reminder, Linda, that if you want to put anything further to augment the evidence that you've given us orally in writing, then please feel free to do that. That might be useful, and I think you alluded to that at the start of those round of questions. And also, it would be helpful for the committee if you could give us the updated figure on the balance when you've got that. I want to turn now finally to a series of questions on the management of the census programme. And I'm going to finish up by inviting Sharon Dowie to come in. But before I do that, I would like to invite Willie Coffey. Willie.
Thanks very much, Richard, and good morning to everyone. Paul, I wanted to start with you and ask a few questions in relation to the mechanism for getting the census split between digital and paper and so on. You talked about it earlier on in the session there, but could you just give us a few more details about how it's going to work? Hitherto, everybody used to get a paper copy delivered to their house, so you could be pretty sure that everyone had it. This way, from what I remember you saying, is that everybody's going to get a letter, and that people who aren't connected to the digital world can phone us up and get one posted to them and so on. But what happens if they don't do that? How are we going to know who hasn't just bothered engaging with the process? And will you have people in place that can check and determine that and then subsequently deliver it to people? So could you just talk us through how you'll manage to get the census into everybody's hands, let's say?
Well, thank you, Mr. Coffey. Absolutely, yes. Yeah. So the letter that will go out across Scotland will, as you say, provide a range of information about how to participate. It will include a unique code for that household, which is the key to accessing the online platform and completing the census return online. But as you say, for those who either don't wish to provide a digital response or who are unable to, paper will still be retained. We have behind the scenes, so we have an online platform that people can fill their census out, but we also have systems behind the scene that track how many requests for paper forms we've received and if we've received them back. So when somebody completes a paper form and posts it back to us, those forms are all scanned and information is read off those scanned forms. So we have a record of forms that we've sent out and the forms that have been returned and the data we've captured from those forms. So we'll be able to use that and generate reports that if we know that people haven't completed their census either online or in form, There'll then be a chain of reminders, so there'll be reminder letters, and ultimately, if there's no response after a period of time, the field force will attend the address and make contact with the household. Hope that helps.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So if people ignore the invitation to complete it, they will still get a visit with a paper copy and invite them to complete it. Good. That kind of covers that. What did you say earlier, Paul, about your expected likely percentage? You talked about all paper or all digital or mixed paper and digital. Did you say something that the has a drop-off rate if you mix these models of inviting the contributions from people? Does it drop off, do you think?
Sorry, Mr. Coffey, if I wasn't clear about that earlier. So what we, you know, so in the census rehearsal that we ran in 2019, we in three local authority areas provided people with the opportunity to participate on a voluntary basis with the census. They were given access to the digital system, and they were also given the ability to request paper forms. In our assessment of how we might have tried to deliver the census in 2021, one option was basically to replicate the rehearsal and provide paper and digital. Our anticipation is that would have provided the highest return rate without using a field force. The paper only was then likely to be the next highest option, and the digital only was likely to be a lower percentage for the reasons we've talked about earlier. So I hope that helps.
Right, okay. But in terms of the data then, if a huge amount of this census is now completed digitally, electronically, who has access to the data, Paul, when it's submitted, and who owns that data and how secure is it and so on? Could you talk us through a little bit about that, please?
Yeah, that's a very important question. So NRS owns the data, and the data is kept confidential for 100 years. So later on this year, we will be publishing the results of the 1921 census, which will be of great interest to historians and genealogists and others. So that data is kept confidential. Everyone who works in the census program signs a confidentiality agreement, but it's also potentially a breach of the criminal law if anyone discloses census data. In terms of protecting the data, we've built very rigorous information governance standards and cyber security and data security standards in the organisation. So our online systems have been subject to independent information assurance reviews. They're being conducted by an organisation called Bridewell, which is a National Cybersecurity Centre accredited assessment organisation. We published our first assessment prior to the rehearsal in 2019. The next one for the census itself will be publishing at the end of January, and that will be made public so that anyone can sort of see the robustness around the security arrangements. We've done a lot of work with the National Cybersecurity Centre, Police Scotland, Scottish Government and others in terms of putting in place robust cybersecurity measures to protect census data and preserve preserve the online systems as well.
Mm-hmm. And the data that's ultimately submitted by a person in Scotland, either digitally or in paper, that data is not used for any other purpose other than the census purpose, is it? It's not given to third parties. They don't have access to it. They have no rights to it. So it's fairly secure, that single purpose only.
If you're interested in more detail, Pete can probably help, or we could write to follow it up. But there are a range of statistical approaches that are applied to census data. So data is anonymized, so that it's not actually possible to kind of identify individuals, because we're not interested in individuals. We're interested in the accumulation of the data. So a lot of work's done to anonymize the data and various other steps, disclosure of control and other things, which means that it's not possible, you know, if somebody did hack us, to sort of extract that kind of individualized data. So that's the kind of processing work that goes on after the census data is submitted. But no, we don't sell census data. It's used to inform the statistics and the purposes of the census.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And in terms of the online submission, Paul, can people do that in little bits and bobs, rather than you don't have to complete it all from start to finish, do you? You could pick up a bit of it and do it later on and submit. Do you have to submit the whole thing at the end when it's complete? So can you take your time?
That's absolutely correct, Mr. Coffey. So when you access the platform, you're able to set up a password and you can complete a bit of the census and then come back to it later on. As long as you remember your password and and you've got your code, you can go through and complete it in stages. Yeah.
And lastly, then, from me, how do you see it developing in the future? I know we might be 10 years away from the next one, but do you see us continuing with this digital solution and a little bit of mixed digital and paper? Do you think that will continue in the future? We'll use that model.
Yeah. I mean, it's very difficult to have a telescope to the future, because so much happens in 10 years. If we think about the technology that was around in 2001 as opposed to what's available to us now, part of the work, and Pete and his team are leading on this, is some work to look at what the future options are around delivering the census. I think it would be hard to anticipate not delivering a census in the future that didn't have a significant digital component, but there is obviously still a very recognisable issue with digital exclusion and digital participation, even though that's increased during the pandemic. I think the other thing that's on the horizon, so our colleagues in ONS are kind of looking at, do we get to a world where we can use other existing surveys and data that exists elsewhere to completely replace the census? Now, they're reporting on that in 2023, and it'll be interesting to sort of see the results. But I think what we're looking at in NRS at high level is, do we deliver a census that's broadly similar to what's being done in 2022? At the next census, or will we use a hybrid of a survey combined with other data sources? But there's a lot of work and a lot of investigation that needs to go on in the next few years in relation to that.
Okay, that's very helpful, very reassuring, Paul. Thank you. Back to you, Convener. Thank you.
Thanks, Willie. And I'm finally going to turn to Sharon Dowie, who's got a couple of questions before we wind the session up. Sharon.
Thank you, Convener. Looking at the management of the Census programme has been subject to a number of reviews over the lifetime of the programme. Challenges first identified in 2018, and in March 2019, the programme status was marked as red. Following the implementation of a recovery plan, the subsequent reviews have noted significant improvements, and a review in February 2020 gave the programme an amber rating, concluding the census would have been able to proceed in 2021 if it had not been for the pandemic. The most recent review, at the end of November 2021, gave the programme an amber green rating. So I've got two questions, and in the interest of time, I'll ask them both together. How is NRS managing risks, particularly around finance and resourcing, in the run-up to the census going live? And what further review activity is anticipated over the remainder of the programme?
Thank you very much for those questions. In terms of risk, we've got a well-developed risk management approach in the programme. We have a dedicated risk group. We manage risk at individual project level, programme level and strategic level. That's reported into our programme board. It's reported into our NRS Audit and Risk Committee. There are deep dive sessions on risk and risk management and current risks and issues in the programme. So we've got quite a well developed risk management regime there. I think the Auditor General, both in his evidence session and in his Section 22 report, recognised that we were doing the right things, but it was that we needed to keep doing them. And I think that's where we are. In terms of resources, we've got the people that we need to deliver the census collection, and frankly, with a matter of weeks to go, there aren't really opportunities to get other people into the programme. So we've got an understood and managed position for the resources to deliver the census collection. Now, there's obviously other phases of the programme. We then get that data, and then we need to do lots of complex statistical work on it, and we need to prepare it for releasing the census results. And so we'll be bringing in some resources to focus on that, but equally there will be people involved in the collection that, as we move through this year, will no longer be required and will be dropping off the programme as well. So there'll be some new people coming in and quite a lot of people leaving at the same time because they're no longer required for that phase of work. Does that help?
Yes, that's fine. So you're quite happy with the processes you've got in place?
Okay. We've got robust workforce planning arrangements, and Linda and myself chair a resources group in NRS, so we keep a very close eye on census resourcing and cost. Yeah,
that's fine. Okay, thanks. Back to you, convener.
Thanks, Sharon. And well, let me just conclude the session by thanking the witnesses for joining us this morning. Paul Lowe, Linda Sinclair, Peter Whitehouse, Anne Slater. I don't think, Anne, we've heard from you, but I know you've been on hand to give evidence. And just reflecting on what you said at the beginning, Paul, look, we understand that you are not the Office for National Statistics, but you are the body charged with delivering the census in Scotland. And that's what we're concerned about, both its efficiency and effectiveness. And we are now, I think today is exactly 2 months to the day until Census Day on the 20th of March. And so it may well be, and it will be for the committee to decide, but it may well be that we will invite you back after the census later in the year, just to reflect on how it went and any other broader lessons that can be learned, as well as considering the future. You mentioned 10 years is a long time. I'm not sure whether the next census will be in 10 years' time or 9 years' time. And that's a question that we haven't touched on this morning, but I'm sure we can return to. Just to reiterate, if there are any, we welcome your commitment to give us a copy of the options appraisal. If there are any other aspects of the evidence that you've given this morning that you think would be supported well by any written submissions, as a committee, we very much would welcome that. And again, thank you for your time this morning, and for the willingness in which you've been able to answer the questions that we've put. I'll now bring this session to a close and suspend the meeting whilst we change witnesses. Thank you. Well, can I now welcome people back to the Public Audit Committee, and we are at item three on our agenda, which is a consideration of the 2020-2021 audit of the Scottish Government's consolidated accounts. And I am pleased to welcome, to give evidence on that report, three people from Audit Scotland. First of all, the Auditor General, Stephen Boyle, welcome. And this morning, the Auditor General is joined by Michael Oliphant, who's an Audit Director, and by Helen Russell, who's a Senior Audit Manager of Audit Services at Audit Scotland. So we've got a series of questions, and we will try and get through as much of the report as we can, but it, I think it makes sense to us that we give the report due consideration, and it may be that we will come back again and have a further session of evidence on this important report in the coming weeks. But I want to begin, Auditor General, by asking you to make an opening statement.
Many thanks, Convener. Good morning, Committee. I'm presenting this report this morning on the 2020-21 audit of the Scottish Government under Section 22 of the Public Finance and Accountability Scotland Act 2000. The Scottish Government's annual consolidated accounts are a critical component of its accountability to Parliament and the public. The consolidated accounts cover over 90% of the budget that was approved by the Parliament in 2020-21. The accounts report the amounts the Government has spent against each of the main budget headings and the reasons for any significant differences. They also show the assets, liabilities and other financial commitments that the Government is carrying forward into future years. My independent auditor's opinion on the consolidated accounts is unqualified. And this means that I'm confident that they present a true and fair view of the Government's finances and that they meet legal and accounting requirements. Convener, I'd like to highlight three areas from my report. The first is the budget performance. The last financial year, of course, was the first in which the Government's spending and funding to support the COVID-19 pandemic reflected fully in its financial performance. Net spending for the year was £50.1 billion. £580 million less than the approved budget, and an underspend, therefore, of 1.1%. This was £10.7 billion more than the previous year, equivalent to 27%, reflecting the significant additional sums of public money that were committed to the public response to the pandemic. High-level details are provided in the accounts over how much this money was spent during the year. My own report, though, highlights the need for the Government to be more proactive in publishing comprehensive COVID-19 financial reporting information, clearly links budgets, funding announcements, spending levels. This will help increase transparency in areas of significant parliamentary and public interest. The second area is on that of financial management. A report provides an update on the status of the Scottish Government's financial support and guarantees to private companies in BIFAB, Ferguson Marine, Prestwick Airport and the Lochaber Aluminium Smelter. These interventions have not delivered the expected outcomes and are unlikely to deliver value for money. The Scottish Government is taking action based on my predecessor's recommendations to develop a framework to outline the principles and approach for future investment decisions for private companies. This should help the Government provide assurance to the Parliament over its strategic objectives in entering into any future agreements. And thirdly, is that of financial reporting. The Scottish Government is committed to a revised timetable for the development of devolved public sector accounts in Scotland. This will be on a two-stage basis. First stage is expected to be provided for audit this spring, followed by a second stage which will incorporate local government spending towards the end of this year. I note this commitment and urge the Government swiftly to deliver progress on this now revised timescale. Convener, as ever, Michael, Helen and I look forward to answering.
Thank you very much indeed. And we have got a long series of questions to ask. And so I want to begin straight away by inviting Sharon Dowie, who's got some questions on one of the themes you identified, financial management, to come in and ask questions. Sharon.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everybody. You actually mentioned it in your open speech there, looking at the tracking of the COVID-19 spend. So the Scottish public sector expenditure in 2020-21 changed significantly from the initial plans due to the response to the coronavirus pandemic. And in-year changes to budgets were reported via three budget revisions, summer 2020, autumn 2020 and spring 2021, primarily due to the additional COVID-19 funding. The summer 2020 budget revision gave a good level of detail on the allocation of the COVID-19 Barnett consequentials that had been received by that point in time. However, the subsequent autumn and spring budget revisions give much less detail on the allocation of further COVID-19 Barnett consequentials, and it's proved very challenging to track how additional funding relating to the pandemic has been allocated and spent. So, three questions. So first one, the pandemic has highlighted weaknesses in tracking in-year changes to spending plans. Again, that's been brought in by the COVID. So how could reporting be improved to enable better scrutiny of in-year changes to spending plans, even when these are on a less significant scale than we had in 2020-21?
Morning, Ms. Dowie. Thanks very much for that question, actually. I'm happy to start. I'll invite Michael. And in a moment, actually, because we'll want to contribute, I'm sure, to this as well. I think the first thing we would say is that, you know, we recognise the sheer volatility and the scale of the change in spending is really stark. There's an additional £10.7 billion or so spent this year on top of the original budget, so hugely significant. Some aspects we welcome. You know, so I think the presence of three additional budget changes mechanisms during the year helped improve transparency. And we would also point to the 300 or so spending announcements, so really unprecedented in scale. But perhaps it's what's the case and what's led us to the conclusion in the report that there needs to be a stronger mechanism to connect the budget to spending announcements than what's actually reported spend, is that the arrangements in place before the pandemic don't really lend themselves to that level of volatility. And so in-year financial reporting will help that. It's a matter ultimately for government to determine the mechanism with which they want to report changes, whether it's, you know, quarterly statements, in-year accounts and so forth, as a way of allowing that tracking and transparency. Before handing to Michael, just to add, I would say that we think the government has improved aspects of its financial reporting in this set of accounts, so that the performance report includes details of COVID spending. You know, it analyses that by various levels, by portfolio. But it's still challenging, Ms. Dowie, to track the COVID spending to the outcomes from that COVID spending on the portfolio basis by which government's accounts are constructed. So there's perhaps scope for government themselves to look at the mechanisms which they report on high level changes, be it COVID-19 or other aspects that may follow. I'll pause there for a moment and just check with Michael if there's anything he wishes to add firstly. Thank you.
I think the Auditor General outlines the key issue there, and that's really the thread that exists between the budget, the in-year spending announcements, the budget revisions, as you pointed out, and the spending against the budget. It can be very difficult to see the amounts moving throughout the year, in particular when we get to the point of looking at the accounts. The accounts are presented in line with the requirements of the Budget Act and requirements around the Financial Reporting Manual. So there's restrictions there with which the Scottish Government have to operate in relation to the accounts, but we're encouraging them to be more proactive in terms of some of the other information that they can provide, particularly as we know the significant additional sums that have been applied to the budget this year, the significant parliamentary and public interest in COVID spending. I think that's shown a greater spotlight on it. So it's really important that the Parliament and the public are able to see the clear line from budget announcements, in-year spending announcements, and what has been spent against the budget at the year end.
Thank you. It has been raised before about trying to get the money out as quickly as possible, and it has actually caused issues getting it out, like showing where the money's actually ended up going. maybe been allocated to a department for one thing, but then was used for something else because of the need for urgent action. But going on to the second question then, is the Auditor General aware of any plans by the Scottish Government to present a comprehensive report on changes to budgets and final expenditure as a result of the pandemic? And if not, would such a report be helpful, and when could it be expected?
So I'm not aware of any plans. Again, I'll invite Michael or Helen to see if they're cited on any plans that you describe of a comprehensive additional report in over and above the outturn statements that the Cabinet Secretary gives to the Parliament and the annual accounts that the consolidated accounts that you have today. To answer your question directly, we always welcome additional transparency. I mean, that's one of the conclusions that we're making in this report, and really reflecting the circumstances that we've seen through the COVID pandemic. And perhaps before that too, I mean, my predecessor regularly made the point in her reporting that the consolidated accounts really only go so far in helping the reader of the accounts understand how well the money's been spent, and the connections that that she made and have continued to promote between the national outcomes and public spending that contributes towards that, is still too hard to actively track the benefits and value that comes from public spending. As it relates specifically to COVID-19, you'll know, Ms. Dowie, and the committee are familiar that Audit Scotland has produced 3 tracker reports on COVID-19 over the duration of the pandemic to try and bring some additional clarity and transparency to the scale of spending. Perhaps in an ideal world, government themselves would be in a position to report publicly on how public money was being spent on this particular aspect as it related to COVID-19 spending. I think ultimately it's a matter for government to decide how best to communicate its spending and what that's delivered over and above the statutory elements of the annual report and accounts. But yes, we always welcome additional reporting that brings transparency to how well public money has been used.
Did you say someone else was coming in there? No.
Apologies, I think that's probably back to you.
Right, okay, thanks. And will you provide a further assessment on the funds committed and spent on the COVID-19 response?
Yes, yes, we will. Yeah, we will, Ms. Dowie. We'll be reporting in a few months' time through our Section 23 report on the use of COVID monies over the course of the pandemic as part of our plans reporting. We'll continue to report through our annual audit of the Scottish Government and through our Forward Work programme on how well COVID money has been spent. I guess one of the things I would maybe reiterate from some of our previous evidence is that it's going to become harder and harder to differentiate between what is COVID-related spending and what's not COVID spending as the pandemic continues. We've seen in some of the budget statements that from elsewhere, for example, in the UK government budget, that they're no longer making that differentiation. So it'll be a matter for the Scottish Government to determine its own choices and how long it wishes to report COVID-related spending. But for the time being, our work will continue in this area and as we look to bring transparency in public spending.
Right, thanks very much. Back to you, Convener.
Thanks, Sharon. One of the aspects that's highlighted in the report, in and around especially COVID-related payments, is the question of fraud and the risks of fraud. And Willie Coffey has got a number of questions on this subject. So over to you, Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning again, Stephen. I wanted to just ask some questions relating to the COVID-19 business grant scheme and the commentary within the consolidated accounts relating to fraud, potential fraud and otherwise. Firstly, could you just give us a little bit of an overview of how you see that, how that process has gone? We know it was a very, very quick process of trying to distribute funds to be as helpful as possible, but we know that also brought greater risks with it. So could you just give us a little overview of how you felt that has gone, please?
Of course. I think it's been mentioned a moment or two ago about the pace of money, Mr. Coffey, that was passed out by necessity to different parts of the economy. And in our report and in the government's consolidated accounts, we're focusing on two of the large business support schemes. The first is referred to as the Business Support Fund grants, which covered the Business Support Grant and the Retail, Hospitality and Leisure Grant. And then the second is the Strategic Framework Business Fund, which also aspects of hotel, sorry, Retail, Hospitality and Leisure top-up grant. Both of those schemes in total accounted for about £1.6 billion of public spending. And I think the nature of the pace of the distribution of that money had to be quicker than would normally have been the case for public bodies awarding grants outside of the public sector, just with the sheer pace, scale, challenges that the pandemic brought. And what we've concluded in our report is that by necessity, the Scottish Government has had to accept additional risk around fraud or error in the distribution of that money. At a headline level, the government has, through its own assessment, is that there's between 1 and 2% of that spending will be attributable to fraud and error. So around somewhere a figure between £16 and £32 million of that is likely to have been spent not in accordance with the associated laws. Just one last thing I would say about that the assessment and the mechanisms, and I'm happy to say a bit more of it, the government and its partners took to mitigate against fraud. But in arriving at that figure of 16 to 32, it requires us as auditors to form a judgment about what does that mean for the accounts? Are they fairly stated? Is there a question about the regularity of that amount? And in our judgment, £16 to £32 million, of course, is a hugely significant amount of public spending that hasn't been spent properly. But in the overall materiality of the government's accounts, we've already mentioned this morning of £50 billion, we're satisfied that the accounts are fairly stated and there's not a question to be made about me altering my audit opinion on the accounts.
That's very helpful. In terms of whether a proportion of that money, Stephen, was fraudulently obtained or disbursed in error, is there an attempt at all to recover any of that money? Whether it was fraudulently obtained or not, are we in a process of trying to recover that, or is that just one of the casualties of the circumstances that we found ourselves in?
So there is attempts to recover it, actually, and I'll pass to Michael in a moment just to say a bit more about the steps that the government and other public bodies are taking. Michael might also want to say a bit more about some of the evidence that the government took in arriving at its judgment about the overall scale of the risks. I think it's important to say is that the mechanisms that the government and other public bodies had in place to guard against fraud and some of the arrangements that they had in place pre-pandemic served them relatively well. And I do caveat that because I wouldn't want to give the committee the impression that up to £30 million of public spending is a positive result. But they were able to protect against other additional fraud. So we report in that we think there's probably around over £3 million of fraud that was actively prevented because of some of the anti-fraud mechanisms that had in place. We're satisfied, Mr. Coffey, that the government has been clear and transparent on this aspect of the accounts and the anti-fraud mechanisms that they got in place. I'll pause. I'll invite Michael just to say a bit more about some of those steps that they took and what they're now taking to recover amounts where they think there's been an error or fraud in place. Michael.
Thank you. I think there's some key data around some of the application process. I think first looking at the level of rejected applications across the different schemes, between 14 and 30% of applications were rejected. So that's really important because that suggests that there's a good control framework in operation that almost stops it immediately. As Stephen mentioned, just over almost 2,200 cases of detected or suspected fraud across all local authorities in relation to these schemes, and that leads to an estimate of likely fraud prevented of between £7 million and £11 million based on average grant amounts. What's also important is only 100 cases actually resulted in payments being made. But as Mr. Coffey, you asked about recoveries, and yes, recovery action is underway. At the point of the end of the financial year, just over £1 million had been recovered, and we're aware that about 115 other cases of recoveries are underway. And absolutely, that is the expectation that where payments have been made, either as a result of fraud or suspected fraud or indeed error, then that these amounts should be actively recovered.
Mm-hmm. One of the lessons that we've learned as an audit committee over the years, Stephen and Michael, is that if local authorities, for example, are involved in a process like this and something is going on, perhaps fraudulent claims to the authority, are we quick? Are they quick to share that intelligence within and amongst the other authorities so that they can be alerted to possible activities like this? Or don't they do that? Or did they have time even to do that during this pandemic? It seems as though they may have done so and collaborated fairly well to try to minimise the impact of this. Is that the case, would you say?
I think that's a fair assessment, Mr. Coffey, actually, that I guess there's two components of it. One is that local authorities have well-established networks of anti-fraud arrangements. Audit Scotland played a part in that as well, and there are through heads of anti-fraud and internal audit, and as you alluded to, the committee's familiarity with the National Fraud Initiative all have set the building blocks in place for strong collaboration to guard against anti-fraud. And I think we witnessed that in real time during the early stages of the pandemic, that for some of the, some of the attempted fraud and where those were intervened to stop, that intelligence was shared across public body, local authorities, yes, and others who were distributing grants. So I think it's a reasonable conclusion to make that established arrangements worked well and that then they were enhanced during the stage of the pandemic in an attempt to minimise but not prevent entirely some of the fraud numbers that we're reporting.
Mm-hmm. And lastly, Stephen, any new lessons that we learned because of that accelerated process in terms of looking at disbursement of public funds and safeguarding it for the future? Is there any lessons that we can learn going forward to help offer us more protection?
So I think it's that there's a case for more opportunity to learn lessons and elections, no doubt, as we have come, best part of 2 years through the pandemic, that the arrangements in place are now stronger than they were at the early stages. Building on some of those established networks served organisations well. Those bodies that were familiar with distributing grants to other bodies outside public sector were able to draw on that. And I think that'll be clearly a matter for government to determine about which of the bodies are best placed to distribute funding, and whether it's done on a portfolio basis, because that's the nature of how money flows through, or whether it's done and given to organisations that are familiar with doing so. I think there's probably scope to think about deploying grants to organisations that's what they do, rather than necessarily saying it has to follow a portfolio spending pattern. As ever, I think you would expect us to say, Mr. Coffey, that we encourage really lots of reflection and lessons learned, not just by government, but really all public bodies who've been involved in the pandemic. And of course, through our own work, we'll look to contribute that as we continue to report, I've mentioned earlier, through our next COVID-19 update.
Okay. Thanks to both of you for those answers. Thank you very much. Back to you, convener. Thank you.
Thanks, Willie. And I know that Craig Hoy wants to come in on this issue broad as well, so I'll invite Craig to come in at this point.
Thanks, Richard. And morning, Stephen. I don't want to put you on the spot. I'm not sure how good your live tracking is presently in relation to the new round of business support. But in December, about £375 million of support for business was announced. The general impression that I'm getting through my post bag and talking to hospitality businesses and such like is that it's actually slower in going out the door than it was before. And I noted that on a Tuesday, the First Minister said, and I'll just quote what she said, we're working with local authorities and other agencies to get the money out the door and into the bank accounts of those who need it as quickly as possible. However, there are checks and processes that have to be applied to guard against fraud. Do you have any impression as to whether or not it is taking longer to process this current round? And is that because there have been lessons learned and there are further checks and balances been put into the process, or could there be other reasons for the delay in this round of disbursements?
To be just absolutely clear, Mr. Clare, I don't have any up-to-date information on the number of 375 million and how well that's going beyond what I've heard the First Minister say in the chamber. There is a balance, if maybe just offer this perspective on it, in terms of continuing to get money as quickly as possible to where it needs to go, together with some form of checks and balance, but that needs to feel proportionate in order to guard against the effective use of public funds, but to get it quickly to where it needs to go. So, unfortunately, no, I don't have any up-to-date information from local authorities or from other public bodies. Again, I'll invite whether Michael or Helen, whether they have anything they wish to add.
No, really nothing to add to that. And it could well be that the Scottish Government have learned a lot of lessons over the course of the last year in how to deploy these funds, you know, quickly, but in order to minimise the risk of fraud and error. And I think we saw over the course of the last year, the year in which we looked at as part of the audit, that the controls and arrangements, you know, did improve as they were learning lessons, you know, throughout the course of the year. So that could be one element of it, but until we look at this as part of the current year's audit, then there's not much more that we can say in relation to that.
Thanks.
Thanks, Craig. I don't know whether, Colin Beattie, you wanted to come in on the issue of social security fraud or whether that's been covered already, but
Colin? Convener, there are one or two aspects of this I would like to touch on, and also I'd like to touch on the European structural funds. Obviously, there's been concerns in the past about social security payments in Scotland and the risk of fraud around that. But a large part of the expenditure, over £3 billion, is administered by the DWP under our agency arrangements with Scottish ministers. So, as far as we're concerned here, and probably yourself, we're not able to establish what the levels of fraud and error might be. But based on the levels of fraud and error reported by the DWP for the benefits that have been paid overall, Audit Scotland has done an estimate that overpayments in Scotland could amount to £65.4 million. Now, that's a lot of money. And how is it accounted for? Does it come back to us as a notional loss? How does that work?
Morning, Mr. Beattie. So our report today covers both the fraud that we talked about through the distribution of COVID funding and also for the Social Security Scotland accounts, which are consolidated into the Scottish Government accounts. That's why we're reporting them here. The numbers that you mentioned are reported in Social Security Scotland's accounts. So, and they're exactly as you described. There is still a component of two sets of arrangements for how benefits in Scotland are paid out. Some are paid directly by Social Security Scotland, and others still remain with the DWP, who act as an agent on behalf of Social Security Scotland. So, for those components that relate to DWP distributing the benefits, they've estimated that there is a range of fraud or error of between 1.5% and 5.2% of the total funds. So that has helped them arrive at an estimated error, as you say, of £65.4 million. And I guess two things to say. One is about the audit perspective on that, and then the other is about the recovery component that you asked. The auditor's view is that £65.4 million of public spending that isn't compliant with the associated laws and regulations, and that therefore they took the view that this impacted their regularity opinion on the audit and made reference to it. The recovery of the amount is something that the DWP will continue to undertake as it, you know, as people's circumstances change and they're made aware of it. As you know, the committee will be familiar, is that the benefits agencies, DWP or Social Security Scotland, can make arrangements to recover benefits that have been overpaid, whether due to fraud or error, and that process will continue. I'll maybe turn to Michael or indeed Helen, just to say a bit more. This is not a brand new issue, the level of error. And the committee may recall from previous evidence that some of the DWP's estimates dated back, memory serves me correct, about 20 years in terms of arriving at a robust and reliable estimate. And that was an initial part of the story as to why there was a concerns about the quantification of the fraud and error. If I may just invite Michael just again to update as to where the DWP have reached in terms of a reliable estimate for Scotland of the level of fraud and error.
So the estimates are more up to date now. Previously, where it was very difficult to get an estimate because I think the data stem back to the 1990s, 1996, I seem to recall. But obviously, you know, times have changed, and it wasn't a reliable estimate at the time. But the across the range of schemes that are delivered by the DWP, the error rate ranges between 1.5 and 5.2%. And that's applied across the different schemes. So carers allowance, that's about £15.4 million of fraud and error. The personal independence payment is probably the highest of that, £65.4 million. It's around £24.4 million. And action like any fraudulent or error payments action will be taken to recover these amounts.
The fact is, they only know if an error has happened or a fraud has happened when they identify it. These are just estimates. Are they figures that we should be concerned about? Are they figures that somehow have to be accounted for? How does this work?
So I think you can take confidence, as Michael confirms, that the figure is more robust. And there's the 1.5 to 5.2% is a range that applies to a different range of benefits. So it's not a scale applying to one category of benefits. There's a number of different benefits within that. If I may step back, I think given that as people enter the benefit system and claim it, much of it is the quality of the information comes from the quality of the disclosure that the person makes. And there is not a 100% pre-verification check for when people claim benefits. And that always brings an additional level of risk. So DWP before it and now Social Security Scotland have to accept a level of risk when they award benefits. And perhaps also like the payments to businesses, Mr. Beattie, that money for the benefit system, there's an urgency that needs to get to claimants as quickly as possible. And Social Security Scotland have stated that, you know, as part of their ethos, one of compassion, get money as quickly out to when it's needed. And in doing so, that brings a level of risk. But to answer your question directly, I don't think you should be concerned about it. I think what matters is that the amounts are correctly disclosed and that where there has been identified of an overpayment of benefits, that there are effective, robust arrangements to recover that, most certainly where that's attributable to fraud.
Do we have an actual figure as to how much is written off? Because this is not a write-off figure. It's just an estimate as to, based on past experience, as to what the losses might be. Do we have an actual write-off figure? Because obviously some's recovered and, you know, action's taken, but some is irrecoverable. How do we identify that?
So I don't have that figure immediately to hand. I'll again invite Michael or Helen just to see if they have that number at their fingertips. If they don't, we can quickly come back to the committee in writing as to how much is written off each year. But just one last thing for a turn to colleagues is to, you're right, this figure here is not a write-off. Now, this is an estimate of likely fraud. The process of arriving at a write-off takes many, many years of attempts at engagement, recovery terms, and trying to locate people. There will always be circumstances where amounts can't be recovered. You know, so whether it's due to benefit claimants passing away, or just leaving the country, or whatever, or just their financial circumstances will never lend themselves to recovering benefits. And I think that's just the nature of these organisations have to absorb some of that level of risk. Again, Mr. Beattie, I'll just pause and invite Michael just, or Helen to see if they know what the number that Social Security Scotland have written off. Thank you.
No, it's not a number that I have to hand, but I'm sure if it's available, we can provide that to the committee. But I think, as the Auditor General mentions, there's a time lag involved in this, just because it takes time to identify whether there has been an overpayment in individual cases, whether it, and then an investigation as to whether that is made an error, or whether it is actually a fraudulent claim that requires, some police action and so on. And sometimes these can be very sensitive cases because of the nature of the payments, and therefore there's an important aspect about how you would go about recovering that amount, particularly from those that are of the more vulnerable in society. But if we have a figure to hand, then we can provide that to the committee.
I would certainly be interested in seeing the figure of the actual write-offs, and I'm sure the committee would too. Let me turn to a slightly different subject, which is the European Structural Funds. Now, the European Structural Funds programme is in suspension. Now, this is not a new thing. Going back over the years, these European Structural Funds programmes get put in suspension quite frequently. Now, the reclaim programme, the reclaim payments are obviously still through the European Commission. Now, there's a risk that's been identified that the payments might not be able to be reclaimed in full once the suspension is lifted. So there's a fairly chunky write-off in 2021 of 16 million and a provision of 28.7 million in relation to future under-recovery of payments. Now, I'm a bit concerned that the programme is going to end in 2023 as a result of the UK leaving the EU. So can you summarise the issues that led to the European Structural Fund programme being suspended, and what the issues are that remain to be resolved in order for the suspension to be lifted?
Yeah, I'm happy to start, Mr. Beattie, and again invite colleagues to supplement my response. Unfortunately, this is not a new issue in terms of the European Structural Funds and the Scottish Government's arrangements to comply with the European Commission's guidelines and requirements. The committee
my understanding
will...
is that. Sorry, I was just going to say my understanding is that the it's notoriously difficult to comply with some of their requirements, and I think a lot of countries hit this problem.
I think that's true. I mean, I'm a former auditor of the Common Agricultural Policy, and the requirements to receive European grants, as was, were onerous. But they were very clear and specific at the same time. So, if you wish to receive European grants, effectively you have to follow the European Commission's rules. What the Commission did regularly was to send their own auditors to sample check compliance for the payments, and they found that the Scottish Government, and particularly some of its partners, there's a wide network of bodies who were involved in the distribution and claimant for the European Structural Funds, but they weren't following the rules. I put it as simply as that, and that led to suspension arrangements. At that point, the Scottish Government took a decision to continue to pay some of the funds out of its own resources, while it took really quite significant and steps themselves to enhance their arrangements so that they met the Commission's requirements. Following subsequent audits and suspensions being lifted, we've got to the point that we're reporting in our report that there's been both a write-off of £16 million and then a further provision, as you know, of £28.7 million of potential under recovery. So significant amounts of public spending, Mr. Beattie, that either won't be recovered or at risk of not being recovered. So on top of that, we're really a situation that has been a difficult story for the Scottish Government in terms of its compliance, audit, suspension, and looking at now the non-recovery of tens of millions of pounds of public spending. Ultimately, it will be a matter now as to what follows next in terms of the Community Renewal Fund and levelling up, and the associated arrangements for compliance, so that that the government is able to have the arrangements in place to demonstrate that and not bring any further exposure or risk to public spending. Very briefly, Mr. Beattie, just invite Michael. I know he's also been closely involved in this, if there are any further wishes.
Just a little to add, you mentioned about the problems that are arising in the first place, and it really is the very strict rules of the European Commission, and they had concerns about the implementation of the management and control system and whether the expenditure was valid after a number of weaknesses were found in validation checks. So this sort of long process has been for the Scottish Government to reassess these claims to ensure that the weaknesses are addressed and that validation checks will meet the satisfaction of the European Commissioners, auditors and the Commission themselves. And then once there is that level of satisfaction, then there'll be a process to go through for the Commission to hopefully lift the remaining fund, the European Social Fund, out of suspension. But the Scottish Government, as part of the accounting around this, they need to be realistic about the likelihood of being able to recover these amounts. And that's why the amounts that have been mentioned have been written off or earmarked for future write-off in this year's accounts.
Now, from memory, in past circumstances where there's been similar suspensions, it's turned out to be the agency delivering who has failed to comply, and that the Scottish Government's left to kind of sort that out. Is this the case again?
Yeah, so that's been a feature of some of these suspensions, so that there are Scottish Government and its partners have been agencies, and when the Commission's auditors have looked at it, they haven't confined themselves just to the Scottish Government. They've also looked at some of the cases at their agency, and that was part of the story why they weren't satisfied that the rules had been followed sufficiently that led to the suspensions. Yes, it's not just the government issues.
What's the implications with the ESF programme ending in 2023? Does that mean if the Scottish Government hasn't been able to clean this up and reclaim any funds it can, that simply it becomes a dead loss? And if so, are there other financial implications behind that?
In terms of longer term implications, I guess we can only answer so far, and it'll be for perhaps our government themselves to better explain their understanding of how the arrangements will end in 2023. But as they've written off £16 million so far, and also I think really importantly provided the further nearly £29 million, I think that gives an indication that there's a real level of uncertainty that they will recover these amounts. Look into the future, whatever the UK arrangements are in terms of stepping into the space that the structural funds occupied, I'm sure that the government will want to be satisfied that it's got the assurance and compliance arrangements really solidly in place, so that they don't fall into the circumstances that they found themselves with the European funds.
Now, you touch on the question of my last question, actually, the new UK government funding programmes. Now, in the past, you've said there was a lack of clarity about responsibilities for the replacement funds and that you were in discussions on that. Has there been any progress on this? And do you have a better understanding of what your role will be in monitoring these funds?
So I guess I'm not able to give the committee the precise clarity that I think you or I would have hoped for at this stage in terms of the rollout of the successor arrangements. I think it's also important to note that the UK government has as part of its arrangements, will be giving grants directly to local authorities and indeed some Scottish local authorities. So the associated assurance and audit arrangements are also still in discussion. So I don't have an answer that can say this is how it will operate yet, Mr. Beattie. So we're still engaging and with discussions with both the government and the other UK audit agencies to confirm how any associated audit arrangements will work. I think one last thing I would say, I think it's safe to say that the audit regime will not replicate precisely the audit regime that the European Commission sought for the distribution of structural funds agricultural funding. And perhaps that's an appropriate thing to say. I think there has to be a reasonable level of assurance and audit activity around it, but not necessarily mirroring exactly what went before.
Given where we are on timing, given that some funding has already been made, it seems quite inappropriate that we don't have any idea as to what the audit requirements are going to be in connection with this. Do you have any timescale?
So in terms of my role, as the committee will know, is to audit the funds approved by the Scottish Parliament. Our audit role in terms of European funding was part of a syndicate and agency arrangement on behalf of the National Audit Office to audit European agricultural funding in Scotland. That's not a statutory component of my role. I will be led in part really by discussions for the distribution of the successor arrangements that takes place between the Scottish Parliament, Westminster and the respective governments, which I think probably will be the larger driver behind the associated audit and assurance arrangements. We'll continue to stay in touch, of course, with the other UK audit agencies in terms of whether or not there would be a request of us to undertake audit where the funds are UK-led. But at the moment, I don't have precise clarity, unfortunately, as to how all that will unfold.
I would ask you, perhaps, the committee is obviously going to be very interested in this when this is resolved. Perhaps you could note to come back to us when you do have some clarity, so that we also understand what's happening.
Very happy to make that commitment.
Thank you, General. Back to you, Convener.
Thanks, Colin. We've now got some questions on a moving area of governmental roles, responsibilities and policy, and that's around borrowing, both resource borrowing and capital borrowing. And I want to bring Craig Hoy in at this point. Craig.
Thank you, Richard. Hello again, Stephen. If I can just start by focusing on capital borrowing. In 2021, I think the Scottish Government borrowed £200 million against its capability of £450 million, and a similar picture in terms of the utilisation of that leverage was quite similar, I think, in 2018-19 and 2019-20. So in your view, Auditor General, could the Scottish Government make fuller use of its capital borrowing powers in order to help meet its capital investment priorities?
So, as you know, Mr. Hoy, the government borrowed £200 million against a £450 million cap on an annual basis during the course of the 2021 financial year. So clearly, you know, there was additional headroom left for it to borrow in that year. And ultimately, it's a question for government to determine, you know, how it so wishes to structure its borrowing arrangements. I think what we've noted in the report, and really consistently with previous reporting, is that it's not immediately clear how the capital borrowing has been used, whether it's identifiable against a particular project or another. Instead, government's response is that it's allocated in totality against its capital borrowing arrangements. And so really, kind of, we note that there are no specific details of how the capital borrowing has been used, but precisely against your question, there was headroom for government in terms of the confines of the fiscal framework borrowing caps, yes.
And just in relation to that point that you make in relation to the way that it's accounted for, would it be realistic for the capital borrowing figures to be supported and detailed either in the consolidated accounts or as part of the major capital projects update?
I think that's a helpful suggestion for government, actually. For we're always advocating additional clarity and transparency on how that money has been used. And it's also, and Michael may want to say a bit more about this, I'm sure, but it's not just the disclosures that you see in the consolidated accounts. There are also associated disclosures in the Scottish Consolidated Fund accounts, which is the mechanism that's used to receive funding from the UK Parliament through the Scotland Office and into the Scottish Parliament's approved budget. And that also makes some disclosures in terms of the capital borrowing arrangements. So there's a couple of places that it's noted, but I think we're also keen to see some additional disclosures against particular projects. The major capital projects, I think, is a good idea that you suggest, Mr. Hoy. Michael might want to come in if he wants to for a moment, just about how that works in terms of the consolidated funds.
Yeah, or just certainly the point about more details as it applies to projects. The borrowing powers that the capital borrowing powers that the Scottish Government have, the rules and framework are outlined in the fiscal framework, and as part of that borrowing, so the Scottish Government can borrow. Usually, it's over 10 years. Sometimes it can be over a term of 25 years. And but what defines the length of loan, the timescales applied, is the sort of underlying assets for the projects in this case. So we're keen, as we've mentioned in previous reports, for the Scottish Government to give more disclosures around the specific projects that the loan funding is for. Quite often it's close to the end of the financial year that the Scottish Government decides on how much it's going to draw down against its annual limit. And this will be a financial management decision based on the amount of traditional capital spending that's going out, the process with or the progress of other projects within the capital spending programme, and how best to ensure that they are achieving the maximum value from the borrowing that they draw down, because at the end of the day it's borrowing and it has to be paid back. So they need to factor in that side of the equation as well as part of the decision.
Yeah, and just finally, a sort of three-part question really in relation to resource borrowing. Stephen, could you give a flavour of how effective you think the Scottish Government has been in utilising its resource borrowing powers? Has the pandemic highlighted any concerns over the scale of those powers? And just looking back to 2017-18, I think, where there was an overestimate of income tax, which then meant that the government could borrow for that. At what point does a forecasting problem become a structural problem if year on year we find ourselves with the same problem? And do you have any concern that if we continue to if we don't meet the income tax receipts that the government suggests, that perhaps that issue about using this to balance any shortfall becomes a structural issue and it's not a forecasting issue? Do you have any concerns in that respect in relation to income tax?
I think some of the factors that you describe will be under very close consideration as part of the review of the fiscal framework arrangements that the two governments will be undertaking shortly. You mentioned the resource borrowing. This is the first year that the government has undertaken resource borrowing under the existing fiscal framework, and that, as you suggest, Mr. Hoy, is to cover for an under recovery or of income tax receipts relative to a forecast that was made for the 2017-18 financial year. There's always bound to be variability, I think it's safe to say, from one year to the next, and especially in some of the earlier years, as through the estimates from the Scottish Fiscal Commission, as those have become refined and even more reliable, I think we'll see perhaps less volatility. But then events happen, you know, so a pandemic, and that will kind of change the nature of likely income tax receipts and more volatility in the job market. It's a matter, I guess, for the parliaments and governments to determine the nature of the relative powers of the fiscal framework. As many others have said, and probably I'll kind of limit my remarks to this, is that the fiscal framework wasn't designed with a pandemic in mind, and the extent to which that then translates to more, less, or fiscal powers that should stay the same, I think that's all, that'll ultimately through discussion as they go through the consultation and review of the fiscal framework.
Yep. Thanks. I'll hand back to Richard now. Thanks.
Thank you, Craig. And just before we finish, one of the things that attracted the committee's attention, Auditor General, was your judgment that it was necessary to spotlight the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. And in particular, you've identified in this report on the Scottish Government's consolidated accounts special payments which had to be made in the financial year 2020-2021 by the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service to the tune of £40.2 million, £40 million of which were payments made to individuals following legal action against the Law Advocate in connection with the acquisition and administration of Rangers Football Club. So by my calculation, 99.5% of those special payments went to individuals in connection with that case. From an audit perspective, we're interested in finding out whether you think that represents for you fundamental concerns about the financial position now which the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service find themselves in.
Thanks, Convener. I'm going to bring Helen in a moment, actually, who will want to say a word or two more about the audit judgments that Audit Scotland colleagues have made in respect of this. But firstly, I thought it necessary to include the financial implications of this in the Scottish Government Section 22 report for two reasons. One is that it's a significant amount of public spending. The Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal accounts are consolidated into the Scottish Government accounts. I've not taken any firm view yet, Convener, whether there'll be any dedicated reporting on this matter that I might undertake. And the reason I'm not really able to form a judgment on that is, as you'll know, that there's to be a judge-led inquiry into some of the circumstances surrounding these events and the associated payments. But I thought, again, in terms of transparency and public awareness, committee's interest, thought necessary to include it in this set of accounts. In terms of the implications of the case and the scale of it, as it relates to the Crown Office's overall financial position, we note that in part in the report, but again, I'll maybe invite Helen to come in actually just to say a bit more. Thank you.
Good morning. Just wanted really to update you on the position, if that's all right. So first of all, the 40 million actually refers to already been spent plus accruals made in the accounts of the Crown Office, which have been brought into the SG accounts. If I can just bring you up to date in terms of the facts, there are six cases involved, two of which have been fully closed and completed. A third case has been settled. I'm sure you will have read in the press that a fourth case has in fact been thrown out by the courts. That leaves two cases which remain ongoing at this point. In terms of the amount spent, it was actually spent in terms of cash during 2021, £24 million. Has been well sort of a lot of news has been in the press about this, obviously, as well. And there are the £16 million of accrued monies there, which reflect legal costs plus the ongoing court cases. And that makes up the £40 million altogether. So yes, I would agree with what's been said earlier. It's a significant amount of money, but the cases continue to be ongoing. Hopefully that's of help to you. Thank you.
Thanks, Helen. I don't know whether you are in a position to give us any estimate, and maybe you are not, but whether you're in a position to give us any estimate of what you think the outstanding exposure to these litigation cases is, in light of what you've said about one being settled, two being closed, and others still ongoing. Do you have a sense of of the value of those cases?
No, I don't. Unfortunately, I'm not able to do that. I don't have that kind of detail to hand. Court cases obviously continue with the costs adding up as the length continues, and they get kind of looked at and worked through the actual court process. Maybe try and make inquiries of the Auditor of Courts together with the Crown Office if they have more of a thought around the actual cost, if that would help.
Convener, can I maybe just...
Please. Just, yes.
I think Helen's right, but I think it's also mentioned is that there, before some of the more recent developments in the cases, there was a figure of £16 million that was the provision for future costs associated with this case. As ever, it's a bit of a, events are unfolding, and that figure will be reliable at a point in time when the accounts signed off late into the autumn of this year. The audit's ongoing, both through the audit of the Crown Office and also the opportunity through the audit of the Scottish Government to report publicly. We'll continue to do that, I think I'd say, but as ever, we're mindful that given that this is a judicial inquiry into the circumstances, when will be best placed to comment further.
Thank you. That's understood. But your door is still open to further inquiry from an audit perspective on what's happened here.
I think that's right. I think we'll keep in terms of public reporting on this, we'll do so where it adds value and increases transparency, and we'll keep an open mind on how that progresses.
Right. Well, thank you very much indeed, and I want to bring this part of our proceedings this morning to a close, and I would like to thank Helen Russell, Michael Oliphant and Auditor General for you giving your evidence this morning. As I mentioned at the start, it's an important piece of work, this audit of the Scottish Government's consolidated accounts. There are many aspects of it which we have not yet had a chance to speak to you about and put questions to you about, and I hope that with your cooperation we will be able to do that in the very near future. Because there are some very important issues of public concern that are contained in the report. So thank you very much indeed. I will now close the public part of this morning's committee before we go into private session. Thank you.